Professor G.D. Yadav, Vice Chancellor of the Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, on 27th Feb 2012, the Marathi Bhasha Din. It was released on the occasion of the first convocation day on 6th March 2012 in the august presence of the Honorable Chief Minister, Shri Prithviraj Chauhan, the Minister of Higher and Technical Education, Shri Rajesh Tope, and the Chancellor, Dr. R. A. Mashelkar. The theme of the song is to respect nature and be in harmony with it by adopting green, clean, and smart chemical technologies, and to serve humanity with complete sincerity. It also talks about a confluence of chemical sciences and engineering with biological sciences and a world with no pollution, be it land, water, or air. Blessings are sought for disease-free long life. The goddess Rasayan Devika is a symbiosis of the basic concept, and the words have been chosen so as to depict that ICT will add to the beauty and charm of the mother nature. The song was equally composed and sung by ICT students Jitendra Tongaonkar, Ashwini Tilak, Swanand Gangal, Prasad Surye, Sharad Dalandare, Aditya Kohli, Amrita Bhavne, Rohini Tangsare, Nupur Rathi, and Zui Raut.
Thank you.
decay.
I now invite the honorable dignitaries on the dais, Padma Shri Dr. S. Sivaram, Padma Shri Professor G. D. Yadav, Mr. Udhat Silkar, and Professor R. V. Adulekar. Thank you, sir. We would like to welcome our guest with us happening. We request Professor G. D. Yadav to express a hearty welcome to the eminent speaker, Padma Shri Dr. S. Sivaram, with us happening for gracing this occasion. Thank you, sir. A warm welcome is also extended to our very own Vice Chancellor, Padma Shri Professor G. D. Yadav, by Professor M. D. Daly. We also take this opportunity to honor Mr. Nimkar through the hands of Professor Adivarekar. I would also request Dr. Kali to present his appointment to our attorney, Professor Adivarekar. Thank you, Dr. Pandey. It gives me immense pleasure to invite Padma Shri Professor G. D. Yadav, our very own Vice Chancellor, to say a few words.
Dr. Sivaram, Shri Ullas Nimkar, Professor Adivarekar, Shri Sivaram Krishnan, the senior most alumnus of ICT, Dr. Giri Bhatt, other invited dignitaries, members of the family of Sivaram Krishnan and his own personal friends, I think a lot of them are here. Ladies and gentlemen, today indeed is a very auspicious day for us because we are having two functions rolled in one. In these days, everywhere you go, they say two in one. So this is a two in one. We have this Dr. Nimkar, lecture. As you know, Dr. Nimkar is a distinguished alumnus of this institute, one of the foremost and pioneering textile technologists of ICT. And his family has given this endowment to have this series of lectures which will be given by distinguished scientists, engineers, technologists, or practitioners from industry. So we are indebted to Ullas Nimkar and his family. They are not just giving this lecture, but they are helping our students in several ways and from time to time. So I'm indebted to you and your family for bestowing this honor on ICT. At the same time, after some time, we will have a Sivaram Krishnan's book. It is like a child for him. This is third child or what? third child, a book, in the form of a book. He will have it in after some time. But very importantly, we have our friend and great well-wisher, former member of my board of governors, Dr. Sivaram, who has been a distinguished scientist, Padma Shri already, the former director of ACL, Patna fellow, and whatnot. And right now he is with Haisar Pune, very distinguished polymer technologist, having industrial experiment, developed technology, and he knows the polymer world. And so, so he had chosen a subject on sustainable chemistry, which is so dear to us here. We have courses in green chemistry, so obviously we teach sustainability. So that topic itself is very interesting. And I'm sure that you will have feast this afternoon. Sivaramakrishnan must have arranged some feast afterwards. So, before that feast, let us have the peace by Dr. Sivaram. And so, once again, I welcome you on behalf of ICT for, accepting our request to give this very important lecture. And that is happening today. It's a very good day for all of us. So, thank you for accepting. And with these brief words, I welcome all of you.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words. I would now like to invite Professor Adivarikar to introduce us to Dr. M.V.Nimkar Endowment and our distinguished speaker for today's event.
Distinguished speaker for today's event, Padma Shri, Dr.S.Sivaram, Honorable Vice Chancellor of ICT, Professor G.D. Yadav, Mr. Ullas Nimkar, dignitaries in audience, my faculty colleagues, friends from industry and academia, students, I extend warm welcome to all of you for today's event. Let me throw some light on today's event, that is Dr. M.V.Nimkar Endowment Lecture and Dr. M.V.Nimkar Foundation itself, because of which we were able to organize today's lecture. Dr. M.V.Nimkar Foundation was started in December 2006. And has been dedicated to the textiles department of ICT. I still remember that day. It was the 50th birthday of Mr. Nimkar, and without any intimation, he walked in our department at about 2:30. We celebrated his 50th birthday, and he announced that endowment. The principal amount of rupees 25 lakhs was deposited as endowment fund, and 50% of the annual earnings are used for development of department. The remaining 50% is plowed back in the endowment fund to ensure that this endowment remains relevant in future too. Some of the activities which are undertaken through this endowment are prize for first and second rankers for all years of B.Tech, M.Tech textile courses, prizes for publication of articles in national and international journals, organization of lectures, workshops and seminars, subsidy for factory visits and complete waiver on expenses for deserving students, grant for students, junior faculty to attend national and international conference, partial travel assistance for attending ITMA held once every 4 years, special welfare for non-teaching staff, funds for special equipment, annual maintenance repair where other funding is not available. I simply cannot put it in words, the significance of this endowment. I can only say thanks, Mr. Nimkar, for this excellent gesture. Let me also thank Padma Shri Dr. Sivaram for accepting our invitation to be speaker for this endowment. Thank you, sir. Let me formally introduce him, Dr. Swaminathan Sivaram, born in November 1946, is a honorary professor and INSA senior scientist, Indian Institute of Science, Education and Research, Pune. He has done his MSc Chemistry from IIT Kanpur in 1967 and PhD from Purdue University, USA in 1971. He has many professional appointments such as Honorary Professor at ICER Pune and Kolkata, INSA Senior Scientist at ICER Pune, Director CSIR NCR Pune from 2002 to 2010, CSIR Bhatnagar Fellow and J.C. Bose National Fellow, CSIR NCL Pune from 2010 to 2016. He has many distinct awards and recognitions to his credit, as the International Award by Society of Polymer Science Japan in 2017, Lifetime Achievement Award, Indian Chemical Society 2015, Honorary Doctor of Science, Purdue University, USA 2010, Padma Shri in 2006, Elected Fellow of Indian National Science Academy, Indian Academy of Science, National Academy of Science, Indian National Academy of Engineering, Indian Institute of Chemical Engineering, the World Academy of Sciences, Italy, Royal Society of Chemistry, UK, a visiting professor for Rapid and Sustainable Product Development, Politecnico di Lerici, Portugal, 2018 to 2022, Harold M. Orton, Distinguished Visiting Professor of Polymer Science, the University of Akron, WIHO, 2006, and many more. He has, to his credit, more than 225 peer-reviewed papers and chapters in books, cited as inventor in 50 US patents and 52 Indian patents, trained 36 PhDs, 20 masters and 15 postdoctoral fellows. I welcome you, sir, once again to deliver your address on a very interesting topic, sustainable chemistry, the only way forward. Sir, too late. The topic is very relevant today. The sustainability challenges in the chemistry and the associated industry are increasingly becoming complex and multidimensional. The complexity of the issues faced by the industry in meeting the sustainability expectations of the stakeholders and the need for a system approach to redesign processes for improved sustainability needs to be discussed. The today's lecture will analyze the challenges and define issues that need to be carefully assessed and addressed before chemistry becomes purely green, safe and sustainable. Before we begin lecture, I would like to invite Mr. Nimkar to shed some more light on the foundation and say a few words. I invite first Mr. Nimkar for his few words and then Dr.S.Sivaram.
First of all, I bring greetings from Dr. M.V.Nimkar, who just last month, early this month actually entered his 93rd year. He's keeping well and he sends his regards to all. Of course, he has fond memories of this department when I told him I'm leaving for the department, he said, would you like to come along? I think half his heart was ready to go and then he said, no, I think let the old memories be the way they are. So I think this is, the endowment is now in the 11th year or 12th year now, started in 2006. And I think the department has done full justice to the endowment. And I think we see in students and in various activities, a great deal of things have been achieved. And of course, I hope this will continue. I would also like to thank Dr. Sivaram for having accepted our invitation. This is a subject that is exceptionally close to personally my heart for the last almost 30 years. Just before we start the subject of sustainable chemistry, I'd like to, for the interest of the audience, that in 2015, the United Nations held the UNIA II, and that was the first time it actually accepted officially the word sustainable chemistry. And it has come in the official lexicon now as a new branch of chemistry. And also in various universities, you have exclusive departments now teaching sustainable chemistry. And I think indeed this is the only way forward. So with these few words, Dr. Sivaram, we are all very eager to listen to what you have to say. Thank you.
Professor G.D. Yadav, my good friend, pillar of this very distinguished Center for Learning, Sri Vilas Nimkar, Dr. C.N.Sivaramakrishnan, who insisted that I come and release his book, and he has been waiting for it for, now I don't know, for the last 8 months, I think, you know. So it so happened that it's going to happen today. Adi Bedkar, the head of the Department of Textile Technology at this institute. Distinguished invitees, ladies, gentlemen, and my fellow young students. It's indeed an honor to be here once more in this, what I believe is a very hallowed auditorium where I have been present in the audience many times, spoken many times, and it's also named after one of my former predecessor director, Dr. Kevin McDermott. And I always said that the DNA of NCL and ICT or UDCT as it was then known is the same, because Dr. Venkatraman carried the DNA from ICT to NCL. It's indeed a great honor and pleasure to be invited this afternoon to speak before you. I'm also honored to pay my own personal tributes to Dr. Nimkar, although I haven't known him very well, but I have learned about him in the last few weeks and months. The topic was in a way suggested to me, okay? So, although being a chemist, or for that matter, anybody who practices chemistry or chemical science, technology, sustainability is not something that you are not thinking about all the time, you know. And so it was not a topic that I was allergic to, but I suggested a few topics and it kind of gelled that this could be a topic of a lecture today. I don't particularly claim to have any unique expertise, except that I am a spectator in this canvas of emerging sustainability paradigm that is today sweeping this world. And therefore, as a practicing chemist, as somebody who has learned chemistry, I can't but watch this with great fascination to see where this whole science is going in the future. I believe that I may be standing here like a preacher trying to convince the believers, because most of you are in some respects associated with chemical field, chemical industry. So you are all believers in sustainability, honestly speaking. Therefore, there is nothing for me to convince you that this is important. But sustainability, I believe, is more than science. It is a change of mindset. And I think what I see around is that each one of us will have to keep repeating this story to ourselves so that we change the way we think and the way we do things. Even in our personal life and eventually in our professions. So, as I said, I'm preaching to the believers, so pardon me if I'm trying to be too elementary, but let me tell what I believe are the nuances, are the issues, the challenges, and the intricacies and the complexity of sustainability as it applied to chemicals, chemistry, and of course the related industry. I'm sorry, how do I do this? I'll correct it, okay? It's the fourth, because you sent me the names of the previous three lectures, so it's the fourth lecture. And I'm very pleased to be able to deliver it today. I think before we start, we must pay our tribute to this great man, in whose honor that this lecture is organized and where I have this privilege of speaking to you today. From what I have learned, from what I have heard, from what I have listened to other people talking about, I think he was a person who was deeply committed, a professional par excellence, deeply committed to his profession, his industry, in science, technology, public policy, and education. I think it's very difficult to get people of this wide and vast interest in a human being, and therefore I always ask myself, how do we remember such people, how do we commemorate the life of such people? And what comes to me is what the wife of Steve Jobs told about Steve Jobs when he died, and I think it is something which touched me, because you know, he has created, of course, the largest company of the world in terms of market capitalization, created more wealth for everybody else in this world, but that's not what she talked about. What she talked about was, I said, to do what you want to do, to leave a mark in a way that you think it is important and lasting. That is a life well lived. And I thought it fits the life of Dr. Nimkar very well. What is important at the end of our journey of life is to have the satisfaction that we have lived our life well. And that is related to only two elements. You know, have you left a mark? And on what is the mark? What is a mark is very subjective. On something that you believe is important, that's it. Whether the world world believes is important or not is really not the consideration. So I think in that respect, I believe that it's very appropriate that we are able to honor this great gentleman, and I'm glad that M.V.Nimkar is here today. So please carry with you our good wishes for a good health and a long life to him in the years to come. Well, we talk about sustainability in a global context, which involves, in opinion, three E's, you know. And I think this is something that all of us have listened to: energy, ecology, environment, and equity. And I think when these three essentially embrace each other, they kind of lock into each other in a unitary goal, we call something sustainable. Because I think that is what we call truly sustainable. And in fact, this equity part of it, which is now embedded in the sustainable development goals that M.V.Nimkar talked about, because equity, without equity, you just cannot sustainability. So you can't talk about sustainability, you know, which is linked with equity in society. And therefore, if you look at the 17 odd sustainable development goal of the United Nations, you will see a substantial part of it is linked to equity, because without that equity in our society, we just cannot be sustainable. I believe that our civilization is at historic crossroads, and we are privileged in this century to be part of this world, but we also have great responsibility, because how we think and act today will determine the future of this planet. And therefore, it's the huge responsibility that this generation has towards what we believe is a sustainable planet. Why is it that sustainability is suddenly in the front pages of every place, in the television, in the newspaper, in discussions, in debates? Why is it in the front page? Because we have realized that we live in a finite world. I don't know why it took us so long for us to realize this. But the fact is, only in the last two decades that we are realizing that we live in a very finite world. And we are limited by what is called the carrying capacity of this planet. And I think that is the revelation, that is the realization that we have reached in the last two decades. We were not concerned about it before so much. Why? Well, the population and the Earth's carrying capacity, I think it's going to be close to 10.5 billion by 2050. Irreversible changes in the global climate, which you're all familiar with. Providing enough food for the people. Depletion of Earth resources, and I'll have something to talk about it as we go along. Essentially related to the fact that there is an unprecedented urbanization that is going on in this world. 70% of this 10 billion people by 2050 will be living in urban cities. And therefore, there is going to be a huge pressure on the urban infrastructure, and that is going to deplete, because the more urbanization you have, the greater that you deplete the natural resources of this planet. Access to energy is going to be an issue, which is both a societal and quality of life inequities in this. There is a great asymmetry in the access to energy, an increasing burden on environment by what we now call end of use objects and materials in a throwaway society. And this is, we are all part of this society, okay? Well, this is what I said. This is something that you would have seen plenty of times. These are the sustainable development goals. And you will see here that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and a few more are all related to equity. Okay? It has nothing to do with science and technology. It's all related to equity. And therefore, I think we have realized that without equity, you cannot have sustainable society. And therefore, it is important that one focuses on this. I encourage those of you who are interested to read this fascinating book by Diane Ackerman, which came out about a few years ago in 2014. It's called The Human Age, and it is from this book that we now give the name to this era or to this age that we live in. This age that we are living in is now being called the Anthropocene Age. Okay, and I think this is how I think history will remember us in the future, just like we remember Iron Age and Bronze Age and so on and so forth. This period of history of the world will be remembered as something that man created. And this term was given for the first time by Diane Ackerman in this book called The Human Age, and it was a subtitle called The World Shaped by Us. And that was the subtitle of this book. And what she wrote in this book in a very powerful way was that humans are leaving an indelible imprint on this planet Earth. And we can talk about many parts of this imprint. I don't want to get into the details, it's all there. But she also said that human ingenuity and innovation capacity is at an all-time high. So on the one hand, we are leaving an indelible imprint on this earth. At the same time, a man and a woman have huge amount of innovative capacity, ingenuity, you know, in dealing with the problems of this world. But she also cautioned, and I think this is something that as scientists and technologists we must remember, that emergence of technology alone is not a guarantee that its benefit will trickle down to humanity at large. And that she gave as a word of caution. So those of us who believe that the panacea for all the ills of the society lies in technology, she said there is a word of caution. Okay? If you start, don't believe that, you know, because that may not be true. And I think it's a very fascinating book for those of you who wish to buy and read. It's a very fascinating book. I've enjoyed reading this book. One of the problems that she talks about, but I have just reworded it in my own word, is the fact that humanity today has an insatiable desire to consume. Never in the history of the world that people have this great desire to consume. Yeah. And in fact, we are using today our resources around 1.7 times than they are being renewed. Okay? If you are on August 2nd, 2018, on August 2nd, 2018, we would have exhausted the current year's, you know, what we call the whatever were the products and services that was available to us from nature, we would have consumed it on August 2nd. And beyond August 2nd, 2018, we are actually living on next year's, you know, assets. And this date is moving by a couple of days every year, okay? So we believe that in some part of the world, people are exhausting the resources by even as early as June or April and May. But the world as an average is now exhausting the resources by August. In fact, this is the plot. This is available on the internet. It's called the Earth Overshoot Day. It will be celebrated. This normally is marked, and this year it will be marked on August 2nd, 2018, to remind us that look, from August 3rd onwards, we're actually living on next year's, you know, assets, not in this year's assets. We have exhausted this year's assets already. Now, this is a reminder that our consumption is becoming unsustainable, and this is an issue that we have to recognize, you know. And imagine, in spite of the fact that still there are close to 4 billion people who don't have the quality of life, you know, 4 to 5 billion people in this planet Earth, you know, who still don't have the quality of life that the rest of the population has. Now, basically, what this is telling you is that our planet is finite, but human possibilities are not. Living within the means of one planet is technologically possible, financially beneficial, and our only chance for a prosperous future. And this is something I think we must recognize. This I'm quoting from Ryan's book. Okay. Well, this is a slide which you see that here is changing. If you see the slide, the green color means biocapacity exceeds ecological footprint of consumption by greater than 150%. The red means ecological footprint of consumption exceeds biocapacity by greater than 150%. There are two extremes. One is the biocapacity is in surplus, the other is human consumption is over, is overshooting the biocapacity. Now just keep looking at it, the map of the world as it changes. If you see this, this is 2012, you'll see a lot of red spaces. All these red spaces means, in all these red space countries, we are exceeding the biocapacity in terms of consumption. And India is also in that, you can see that, okay? We are all exceeding the biocapacity in this country. And you can see, if you look at the 1961, you saw very little reds. In the world, you see 1976, 86, 91, 96, 2001, 2006, 2012, we are generating more and more places in the world on this planet where the biocapacity is becoming limiting for growth. Now, this is a very, very important revelation for us to understand that this is the planet in which we are currently surviving. Well, there's another thing that I thought we must all understand, because this is something that is very well known, but I found that not many people in general, especially the public at large, hasn't appreciated this. And to me, this is a lesson in sustainability in a broad sense. There is a paper which I recommend many of you to go and read. It's a paper by a well-known biologist from the University of California, but he actually wrote this paper in terms of a social concept. It's called the tragedy of commons. And this tragedy of commons is embedded in our philosophy of sustainability. And this tells us how human behavior is something that is going to define sustainability. It is not technology, it is not science, it is ultimately human behavior. And that's what he wrote this paper in 1968. So you can imagine, he thought about it well ahead of any one of us. Now, one of the things that we all believe is that if something is cheap, it's good for the society, okay? Because we all want everything less expensive, right? Everything we want it to be cheap. The cheaper they are, the more misuse that happens to that whatever that product or material is. The easiest way to actually make something more sustainable is to make something more expensive, okay? The more it is expensive, the less I consume. But this is something which is antagonistic to economics, right? Economics tells us that I want to make everything lower and lower cost so that people can afford it, all right? Now this is a dilemma in society, okay? Would you like to have something very cheap? Or would you like to have something very expensive, okay? And what is the balance that you need in order to make the society sustainable? Now, just want to talk about 2 minutes about tragedy of commons. For those of you who have not understood the implication of tragedy of commons on sustainability issue, the biggest fallacy that we make, in fact, this is a fallacious argument that we every day make, we believe that decisions that are reached individually, best on rational thinking, will in fact be the best thinking for the entire society. It's a wrong, it's a fallacious argument, it is wrong. But this is the foundation under which the democratic societies of the world have been built. Okay? That each one of us are rational human beings. We think for ourselves, we take a decision. And if everybody in this audience takes a very rational and thoughtful decision, It is the best thinking for the entire society. That's what most people believe, but it's wrong. It is not true. Okay? In fact, as rational human beings, each one of us are trying to maximize our gain. Each of us are locked into a system that compels us to increase our gains without limits in a world that is limited. And that's the problem. Ruin is a destination towards which the humanity rushes then. Each pursuing her best interest in a society that believes in freedom of the commons, the freedom of the commons leads to tragedy. And that's the lesson that we learned from Hardin's very thought-provoking paper that he wrote. Actually, it was a convocation address he gave at the University of Utah, which later was printed in the Science magazine. And I think at that time when he made this statement, many believed it was counterintuitive. But today we know that everything about this is true, and this is exactly what is happening today in this world. I'll just give you an example, the last paragraph there, this is related to, let's say, a chemical industry, you know. I'm discharging my waste in a stream. I'm a very rational human being. I do all my Excel calculations, okay, economic analysis, and I decide that my waste, if I don't treat it and I discharge it, the cost I'm saving, right? If I have to treat it and discharge it, I have to incur an additional cost. So as a rational economic decision, I say, let me just discharge it without treating. Everyone thinks like this. Everyone is trying to save the cost, okay, and so that he can pass on that benefit to the consumer. What you're doing in the process is, if everyone thinks the same way, we end up following our neighborhood. Okay. Note, everyone was behaving rationally. Nobody was doing anything irrationally. And everyone will justify their judgments. But that is causing great harm to our society at large. And this was Hardin's thesis that he made in 1968. Now you apply this concept to everything in sustainability, it's true. Because when it comes to sustainability, each one of us are very rational. Each one of us do our very, you know, deep calculations and say that this is the best thing they can do to meet the consumer, to meet the customer's need, to meet the environment needs. But then if everyone does it, honestly speaking, it is not necessarily the best decision the society is making. And that was the, you know, argument that Hardin made, and which I think is very, very important in the context of today's discussion on sustainability. So, in fact, when it comes to chemical businesses, it is now believed that close to almost 300% more businesses compared to today will be actually be affected by scarcity in the next 20 to 30 years. Okay? Because of the fact that we have been very unsustainably depleting our resources. And therefore, the consequence of this tragedy will play out in the next 30, 40 years. And this is going to be a reality. We can't now do anything about it because all the rational decision that we took in the last 30, 40 years has led us to this situation today. Well, the global efforts, in my opinion, on sustainability will be won or lost in our cities. And I keep emphasizing this, okay? Because cities are going to be the most vulnerable part of our society. Where 70% of the world population will live by 2050. Imagine, 70% of about 10 billion people will be living in urban areas, okay? Cities will have to learn to live within the planet's resource budget first, before we talk about other places, you know. Learning to live within the limits and carrying capacities of the natural world is, in my opinion, a non-negotiable imperative at this point of time. John Bernard Shaw, a man who had nothing to do with chemistry, but I think he made a very nice statement. We are very wise not by the recollection of our past, but by the responsibility of our future. And I think it makes eminent sense to remember his word today, because as society in 2015, 2018, it is our responsibility to the future that is going to kind of define this generation of people as wise or fools eventually. Well, when did it all begin? Why is it that today we are in this great turmoil with regard to sustainability? The defining year, if you want to say what that time was, the defining year was the publication of this book in 1968. I was a young student at that time in the United States, you know. And there was a huge outcry about this book in 1968 by a lady, a very frail lady who was suffering from terminal cancer, okay, who was battling death, and she wrote a book called The Silent Spring, which has become an iconic book today. In fact, it is a watershed moment in the history of chemistry, or the history of science, or the history of society at large. She, for the first time, said that, look, we as a society must not use indiscriminately chemical pesticides, okay? And she went after three companies at the time, Dow Chemical Company, FMC, and one more, I forget. Incidentally, all the three companies went after her, okay? Because she created so much damage to these three companies in 1968, they literally went after her in order to finish her off. Because that's a sordid story of chemical industry of 1968, you know. It is a sordid story. In fact, there's a beautiful movie that talks about how these companies using muscle and money went after her to discredit her completely, to say that what she's saying is not true. History proved that she was right. And the companies, now all these companies like Dow and all, they talk about sustainability, you know, with a great amount of evangelism, but they don't realize that they went after her, you know, with tongs, literally with tongs, you know, okay? Public perception of chemistry changed forever from 1968. I was just in the process of learning chemistry in 1968 as a graduate. Industry first reacted with retribution and vindictiveness, enormous vindictiveness, you know. Every life support system was withdrawn from her. Money, she was fired from her job, you know. She was an ecologist at the Cold Spring Harbor Laboratories in Massachusetts. She was fired from the job for writing this book, okay. Because companies were funding these institutions, okay, and she was relegated. She fought her cancer as a lone person, and she died, of course, as a victim of cancer, but she stood her ground, you know, in spite of that. In fact, this led eventually for people to start thinking. Fortunately, wisdom prevailed and introspection began. And to me, that is the beginning of this sustainability journey that we are talking about today. Well, chemistry has had a hurried past. You know, chemistry has given us a lot of good things. Nobody can blame us, right, as chemists. Aspirin, indigo, ammonia, antibiotics, Lipitor. Most people above the age of 50 will be on Lipitor, okay? Nylon, Teflon, polyethylene, synthetic rubber, fuels, rayon, so on and so forth, okay? Nylon stockings, packaged food, bulletproof vests, whatnot. Everything has been given to us by chemistry. But why? How come the chemistry no longer captures the public imagination? I tell you that this is true, that chemistry no longer captures the imagination of the public today. Why is the public perception of chemistry so low?
in spite of such wondrous contribution to society by chemistry, and I speak as a chemist, you know, as a person who has practiced this profession, why is it that we are ranked, actually somebody said, next to nuclear physicists, chemists come at the lowest rung of a ladder in a society, you know? I mean, the first thing the society does not trust is a nuclear chemist or nuclear physicist, and after that, the chemists, you know, okay? How come that we have reached this stage today? Well, it's a malign science, okay? And we all know this. And it's a malign science because we've had these famous names which are etched in the memories of the society. The Love Canal, the Minamata, the Bhopal, the Thalidomides. Everything was a catastrophic event in the history of chemistry, which gave us this bad image that chemistry can only do damage to society. The question is, these were all in the 1970s, 1960s, 1950s. If these were mistakes in the past, are we wiser now? Is a question that is worth asking. We can say, oh, we were ignorant at that point of time, but we are very smart today. Are we very smart? History tells us, no, we are not. Still, many things are happening today in the last few years, even as we speak today, that does not give chemistry a good image. Well, I'll show you some pictures. Everything is not in the past. There are many names here you will see, many structures that you will see. Companies have ended up paying billions of dollars of damages, you know, in the process. Which includes DuPont, which includes PFOA, which is polyperfluorinated octanoic acid, water contamination by chemicals across many parts of the United States. Well, this is something that is very hot. You know, June 23rd, you know, you're going to be, you know, you can't use your plastic bags. Okay? Why is everything is now becoming something that we are not, chemists are responsible for? Okay, so what do we do? They're asking, you know, is there too much polymers? How do we package materials without destroying our communities? Well, we all keep this bottle here, you know. It's just a gentle reminder that we can avoid these bottles in institutions, okay? We don't have to use these bottles. Because these bottles, my friend is here, I think we have to use less and use where necessary, Dr. Abu, okay? And the reason is that the consumption, the bottles are great, there's no problem, okay? The consumption is unsustainable, okay, for a society. And I think we have to recognize that technology may be great, but the use of technology could harm the society in some way. It doesn't mean that technology is bad, okay? But the question is, how do we use it is important. And here we see that 500 billion bottles are consumed in the world. We produce 20,000 PET bottles every second, and every second we throw away about 2,000 bottles, you know, okay? Unfortunately, it's physically impossible for any infrastructure to recollect them and reprocess them and reuse them. It's just not possible. So I think these are issues that the society is confronted with. Believe me or not, if we do not regulate, self-regulate the use of these bottles, the government has only two solutions, okay? Ban, close. The government has no other solution, okay? For any problem, the government will have only two answers. Either you close it down, or you ban it, okay? The rest of them don't care what happens after that. I think it is for us to regulate ourselves. As industry, as public citizens, as civil society, we have to regulate ourselves. I'm glad that things are happening today. I think, you know, now in many five-star hotels, you don't get plastic bottles. They fill a glass bottle and they give you a glass, you know, I think it's okay, you know, it doesn't make any difference, okay, so why are we doing it, you know. Where is necessary, we should use it when you are traveling, when you are maybe carrying water with you somewhere, but I mean, why do you want to do it in other places where you can have access to clean, pure drinking water by other methods, you know. Well, that's the consequence. Because of that, now the world is at the midst of a raging controversy today, which is the so-called microplastics, you know, in the oceans. Now, this has become now a global issue, because it's like carbon dioxide. It doesn't make a difference, you know, where the waste is generated. Ultimately, the oceans are all connected, you know. And therefore, in a connected ocean, it doesn't matter whether America dumps it or India dumps it. It all ends up in the same place, okay? Now, it so happens that the Godavari, Ganga and Yamuna rivers are the third largest carriers of plastics into the ocean. Okay. These three rivers carry the largest amount of plastics into the ocean, the third largest, okay, in the world. So, the question is, what do we do as a society? Whose problem is this? Who is going to regulate this? Who is going to solve this problem? If you don't do that, that's what's happening. You see here, this is March 29th, 2018. You know, you got something like 30 kilograms of plastic, two whales died. You know, one from one, you got 60 kilograms of plastic, the other got 30 kilograms of plastic. Both of them choked to death, okay, because their excretion mechanism failed. Okay. The world will not take this lightly, okay? Apart from the fact that a whole lot of toxic residues from many of these materials are entering the food chain today. 3 billion people of this world depend upon oceans for their proteins. Out of the 7 and odd billion people today, 3 billion people of this world depend upon the oceans for their proteins. And much of the toxic residues from many things, not only plastics, are all entering the fish and therefore entering the human biological cycle. So this is something that we can't say this is not my problem, this is somebody else's problem. It is our problem, okay? And I think we have to wake up to this problem and resolve this problem in one way or the other if the planet has to survive. Well, closer home, let me come, okay? Now you have heard, you have seen this pictures every summer, okay? We don't have a solution to this problem, okay? The government has no solution. Nobody has any solution to this problem, okay? Nothing you can do about it. Now it's too late in Ukraine to do anything about it, to kind of reclaim this entire dump yard, okay? Well, this is something that is happening right now in your neighborhood. So I'm just trying to say, why is it that chemists and chemistry is getting such bad press? You know, this is happening right now. The amount of toluene and benzene in air in this place is 6 times the tolerable limits. Okay? And this is as per the Maharashtra Pollution Control Board analysis. Okay? And this entire, you know, area is choking by excessive amount of benzene and toluene that people are inhaling, living there. You know, 30,000 people are victims to this. And I think, again, chemistry, ultimately it is chemistry, because everything there is chemistry, you know, in the environment. Well, this you have seen pictures of these kinds of things. We watch on our television and we say, oh, thank God I am not in Delhi. Okay? But don't worry. What's happening in Delhi will happen everywhere else. It's a question of time. Okay? Well, this is something that we have seen. You know, lakes are frothing. This is actually Yamuna River in 2017. And this is a famous lake in Bangalore. No solutions as yet. Okay? Well, that's what you can see. It's a joke. Okay? Cartoon. So, I mean that's the plight of urban, environment today. You know, that we live in. No wonder people have no credibility for chemistry. Or no wonder people think that chemists are the worst people in the world, you know, honestly speaking. Because they create a problem and they can't solve the problem afterwards. Okay? So that's it, you know. Well, you see here, now this is a big company, okay? Too big to fail. Many people say, I am a big company, so nothing can happen to me, because I am too big to fail. Okay, small companies are too small to survive. The big companies are too big to fail. Okay? So